Okay, everybody. Hope you had a good lunch. We tried to get a topic for right after lunch that would keep everybody awake. And so we decided, some of you may have heard that the Texas legislature met this spring and decisions were made. And we thought we'd talk about that. And so after lunch, when everybody's getting a little tired, we thought, okay, how can we keep the energy up? And I think there's plenty to talk about today. We have with us Beaman Floyd, who works with TCCTA, and I believe this is our fifth or sixth session working together on community college issues from the faculty perspective. And we had, I would say we had more to work with this session than we ever had, as far as, I mean, it's always funding and something else, maybe a couple of things. This time it was everything all at once, all the time through the session. And so it was, I think our big effort with that as an organization was trying to keep our members up to speed on what's happening so that you had perspective on the issues and at the right time you could chime in on it. When a bill was coming up, things were moving, to let people know now would be a good time to call your legislators. So it was an interesting perspective, and we'd like to talk about some of those issues that we were focused on. Steve Johnson is with us also. He is in charge of governmental affairs for the Texas Association of Community Colleges, the President's Association. Different set of issues often in terms of priorities and things that they're focused on, but coming very much from the same point of view as TCCTA in terms of what we really want out of the legislative session. And so we work very closely with TACC to make sure we know what they're working on, they know what we're working on, and as issues present themselves, we're both interested in to work together on it to maximize our voice. And that's been a very productive relationship for a number of years, and we've valued the partnership with TACC. So we thought getting both, again, bringing these perspectives together in one room to talk about it. What did y'all see this session? What were you focused on? What kind of took the most time, the most energy? What was the biggest impact on our colleges coming out of the session? And observations that you had about the issues, as well as kind of the state of the legislature right now. A very different composition, some different dynamics happening within the legislature, and how that affects our schools. So that is your assignment for the next hour and a half. And as we go, if y'all have questions, I'll have the microphone so we can kind of keep the conversation going. So Beaman, why don't you start?
Sure. Thank you, Richard. I guess we'll start with the last thing first, if that's not gauche. Richard said something about the state of the legislature. As we move toward this last legislative session, we had frankly more question marks as people who work with the legislature than we had had in many, many years. And there were a bunch of different open issue questions coming into the legislative session. First and foremost was the tremendous change in leadership. As most of you all know, Governor Rick Perry served for a long time. And by a long time, I mean a really long time. I have a daughter who was a sophomore in college this past year. She was in kindergarten when he was elected.
Yeah, my son likes to point out he'd never known a governor besides Rick Perry. He's a sophomore in high school.
Yeah, he thought it was a lifetime appointment. So, and because Rick Perry held that office for so long, as all of you all know, it created this sort of a static situation in the statewide offices in Texas, and as it turns out, down into the legislature. Normally, there's sort of a movement through the offices, sort of a political career ladder, if you will. But with Governor Perry at the top rung of that ladder for as long as he was, it created this sort of static. That coupled with the fact that there really weren't serious challenges from the Democrats for statewide office in the years between 2002 and 2014 kind of left us with this peculiar artificiality in Texas politics, that we had this very static regime that we had the same person appointing officials for a long period of time, and most of all that you just didn't have movement up and through the legislative ranks in the same way that you would normally have in terms of leadership. When Governor Perry announced that he wasn't going to run and Governor Abbott announced that he would run, this created suddenly a whole bunch of movement, right? You had people moving from one office to another, and that didn't just create a change in the statewide offices, it created changes in the leadership level of the legislature, affecting you quite directly. Dan Branch took the opportunity, he was the chairman of the House Higher Education Committee, he took the opportunity to quit being in the legislature and run for Attorney General. He didn't get the office, but he also didn't get to run for the legislature again. And so that created movement in the legislature in terms of leadership on your issues. And this happened across the board. So when we were going as your advocates, and when you were going as your advocates into the legislature, we were approaching some fairly significant changes. I think it's fair to say that we had a pretty significant personnel change in both houses of the legislature and obviously in the leadership. I think it is very fair to say that the Senate got more conservative to the extent that that's a definable term than they had been before. They got more on the political spectrum, the common political spectrum. The Senate moved more toward the right than they had been previously to the extent that that affects our issues. We are nonpartisan, and yet there are certain partisan shorthands and partisan sensibilities that very much affect our business, as you know. We had significant question marks about just basic expertise, because when people change, staff changes too. So the question is, how many man and woman hours or years of experience would we lose in this dynamic shakeup of the legislature? And the answer was a lot. And I cannot emphasize this enough to you all as citizens of Texas. You all know, how many of you have been on your job for more than 10 years? How many of you think you know more than you knew 10 years ago? Right? I mean, you learn your job, right? And this is the same holds true in the halls of the Capitol. We had a lot of really, really, really new people in the Capitol from top to bottom. Just absolutely amazing. And we had people who moved from one job to another, so even though they had man and woman years of experience in the Capitol, they were doing stuff that was fundamentally different than they had done before. And so you had, in some cases, sort of a patina of expertise, but it really didn't correlate to the job at hand when you got down to the real hard work in the legislature. And so all of this created a set of gigantic question marks for us moving into the legislature. At the same time, we had big question marks about the number one thing, which was money, and how we were going to be funded. We had a couple of very serious policy issues that we knew were coming up. We had guns on campus, obviously. We had some governance and structural issues that had manifested themselves in the campaigns, notably block scheduling, that were very important, and that commitments were made to in the political process that then had to be hashed out in the policy process. And we had this ginormous question mark. Will Ferrell tells me that's a word. It's ginormous. We had this huge question mark about money and what the Eagle for Shale really meant and what where the economy of Texas really was in terms of the rebound from 2008 and all of those things. Steve's going to talk about budget issues and can talk about some of the projections and then where we are now. But suffice to say that we had more uncertainty. More things to which I, as a professional lobbyist with a couple of decades of experience in the legislature, I got asked a lot of questions in the fall, and I got to say, I don't know, a whole lot, because it was the honest answer, and because we really didn't know a lot about the composition of the legislature and how it was going to work and how strong the commitments in the campaign were going to be turned into policy commitments as we went through the legislature. What we found out was that those campaign commitments were really serious, and we had a lot of things to deal with that were somewhat difficult issues. And we found out that the fight for dollars in the legislature was really a difficult fight, with a lot of nuance to it. And so if that's cool with that, we'll start out. Steve will talk about budget stuff a little bit, and I'll jump in, and y'all feel free to jump in as well.
So to echo a little bit what Beaman was saying, I think one of the things that I noticed mostly in terms of this large turnover of leadership and staff was in the executive branch. You know, we josh about Rick Perry having been there so long. One of the advantages of having a governor that has been there that long is that you know what the policies are. The other advantage in some ways when Rick Perry became governor is, if you remember, he came from being lieutenant governor, and he already had a set of policies, particularly around education and higher education. When Governor Abbott was elected, I mean, he came from the Attorney General's office, has never been in the legislative environment, has never had to deal with other policy areas. And so I think there was a larger vacuum at the executive level than we've seen in probably 15, 20 years, really since George Bush took over from Ann Richards. And so that meant not only did he come in with less of a developed policy, but he didn't have the staff ready to go. And so that created a lot of uncertainty, more at a policy level, I would argue, than at a budget level. But then on the budget side, we had a significant amount of turnover. We started the session with new chairs of both budget committees. Jay Nelson took over as chair of Senate Finance from Tommy Williams, who'd retired. And Jim Pitts, long-term appropriations chair, retired and was replaced with Representative Otto, Chairman Otto. Now, most recently, we're going to go through it again next cycle. I'm jumping ahead a little bit here, but Chairman Otto's already announced he's not going to come back for next session. And so we'll be looking at another new appropriations chair as we head into the 85th session. When it comes to money, I think Beaman's right. There was a great deal of uncertainty. The one thing two things we knew for certain going into session at the top level. One, they had lots of money to spend. There was revenue available, significant amount of revenue, both because of the increase in revenue that was coming from Eagle Ford Shale, sales tax, all of those revenue sources were on the increase. They also left money on the table from the previous session, and they've gotten in the habit of doing that, not spending all the money that they have. You know, with biennial budgets, I mean, I argue we really don't have biennial budgets anymore, because they come back with a supplemental budget right before we get started in a session to cover all the costs that have been incurred over the past 18 months. But clearly they had lots of money. The other thing we knew for sure was that they wanted to not spend a lot of that money. They wanted to provide some sort of tax relief. And so much of the discussion, and I know Beaman was in the middle of it, was the two chambers arguing over how to provide that tax relief. On the Senate side, they were clear that they wanted to do property tax relief, and on the House side, they were clear they wanted to do sales tax relief of some sort, or a rebate, actually a reduction in rate. The only thing they could agree on is they both wanted to give some sort of franchise tax reduction. But you know, I've been around 20 years as well around the legislative process. When I was staff in the 90s, I worked for a House member, and I think we've kind of come full circle. For the last maybe decade, within the legislature, you know, the enemy has been the other party. Well, when I cut my teeth as a staffer, it was always the opposition's the other party, the enemy's the other chamber. You gotta make sure that they don't get their way. And I think we've come back to that kind of a mode now, where the two chambers are obviously Republican, led by Republican majorities, but they have very different views of how to proceed and how to govern. So as we went into session, particularly for community colleges, we knew there was going to be money available. There are the pressures in place on public school finance, and we can talk a little bit more about that because the court has yet to rule at the Supreme Court level. But I think everyone knows that there's going to have to be new dollars put into the public ed system. There were those during this legislative process that wanted to spend dollars now to do that. Others said, let's hold off and keep money on the side. What we were really focused on was trying to get funding levels back on a full-time student equivalency closer to the levels pre-cut in 10-11. If you remember, we had that 11 session where we had the huge run-up in enrollment, and comes at a time, obviously, usually, when the legislature goes, we don't have any money for anything. So we were trying to get back there on the funding level. But part of that was, as you remember from last session, we advocated for and we saw adopted a new funding mechanism for community colleges with essentially three pots of money. One is core operations funding, a flat $1 million for every college. 10% student success points funding, and then the remainder being contact hour funding. So going into the session, we wanted to make sure that they understood that they needed to fund student success points at a level that we would actually see outcomes-based funding realized. The problem is they did not do that, and we can talk a little more in detail there, but the House decided early on that they were going to maintain the 90-10 split at the expense of what the cost per student success point was. And our argument had always been, if you don't fund the formula at a level to get success points up to $185 per point, then for goodness sake, fund that first and don't worry about the 90-10 split. Both chambers had very different views on that. In the end, the House prevailed, and they saw the 90-10 split as more important than what the success point numbers were. So we've got some colleges that generated more success points that won't receive additional dollars, and that's a problem. And if you want to,
yeah, and that's I think what Steve talks about is interesting here. The House and the Senate compete, and there is really a strange electoral issue in the great state of Texas, in that if you were analyzing elections in the House. For where they stand in the intra-party issues related to the Republican Party. That is, if you were saying, we want to understand whether the Tea Party is on the rise or not. We want to understand whether, you know, what sort of the flavor of conservatism is really making strides inside of the party. My opinion only. If you analyzed the House of Representatives, you'd say, well, it's sort of a stalemate, that you've got these sort of dynamic tension between people who could be viewed as moderates and people who could be viewed as more Tea Party or more conservative. In the Senate, you would say, wow, we're really moving in a hurry toward the conservative end. There is a markedly different character being expressed, interestingly, by you all and your fellow Texans. So you've got the same bunch of people voting in these races, and they're generating a different result based on the size of the districts that are in question, which is really weird. I think if anybody's seeking a PhD in government, this is a fantastic dissertation, because it really is. Just academically, it's profoundly interesting. How is it that you can have the same electorate voting in the same elections and getting a divergent result in different kinds of districts? And yet I think that's precisely what's happened. And what it has led to, as Steve was saying, you know, what goes around comes around, it has led to a strong reemergence in the immediate conflict between the House and the Senate. I mean, that thing was teed up. It was very clear from the very outset that was going to be the text of a conversation. And at some point or another, and this is what gets interesting for us, is that the desires and the expressions of the constituencies can sometimes take a back seat to that in the inflamed pressure cooker of a legislative session, a 140-day legislative session, when everybody's living on 26 acres downtown Austin. And you're getting in there and saying, you know, here's what the rest of Texas thinks. And they're like, but those guys, you know, right across the marble, they're the problem for us, you know. And it's kind of interesting, and particularly interesting, I think, for y'all, because you're leading from the middle, right? You are the people on which these big catapult rocks land as these guys are flinging stuff back and forth between the chambers. Once upon a time, I told Richard this, I'm always looking for a way to end my viability as a lobbyist by doing something cheeky and never being able to work in this town again. And one of the things I wanted to do was publish a comic book called Planet 26, which is about how these people on Planet 26 all say these things and they think they have no meaning, but every time they talk, this secret cannon goes off from underneath the planet and destroys another planet somewhere else. And that's kind of the metaphor, right, exactly. Wow. Which is why I haven't done it, because I need to get my kids through college. But the point is that part of our job is to go in there and say, look, you know, we understand that you guys can have differences of opinion, and valid differences of opinion. You have a bifurcation in your funding, which essentially creates the space for competitiveness between the two chambers. That being said, don't land rocks on you guys. And that becomes that really became, I think, our work for the session, especially in the second half of the session as we headed toward.
I think that's absolutely true, and I think that, you know, it's interesting on the House side. I think Beaman's right. The Senate has definitely moved more to the right as we've gone through this last couple election cycles, and particularly this last. The House, however, is operating really on almost a parliamentary coalition kind of a system, where you've got the Democrats with some more traditional. I hate to say moderate, because the Republicans hate when I say moderate, but traditional Republicans in the form of Speaker Strauss and some of his lieutenants that can put together an operating coalition at the exclusion of some of the more conservative members of the House. That puts them at odds, quite honestly, with the Senate. I think the other thing is, you know, not only did we have new members, which creates both challenges and opportunities. I mean, the challenge is you try to explain what higher ed is and particularly what community college is, but that's an opportunity, too, to try to create in their mind a narrative about the role that community colleges fill in this state. But many of the members, particularly in the Senate side, had never held public office before. The House member I used to work for is now as a congressman. At the time he was in the State House, he was a committee chair. He had been the mayor of a city and understood that you had to have things work. You have to invest money, you have to form coalitions, you have to compromise. And many of the new members, particularly in the Senate, their operating paradigm is, I've come here to prove that government doesn't work. And then make sure it doesn't work in some ways. I will tell you that the one thing that they really agreed on when it came to higher education and what they needed to do for higher education, and this was part of the issue for us this session, and I think Beaman would agree, was they could agree that the universities needed tuition revenue bonds. They needed money to be able to spend, particularly the regional universities, to build new facilities. It had been 8 years, 10 years since the state had funded tuition revenue bonds. That doesn't affect UT Austin, where I'm from, or A&M College Station. Buildings get built at UT Austin regardless of TRBs. But those regional universities needed it. Well, that was $250 million. And if you've only got so much money that you're looking to put into higher education, that's the top of the priority list, and you take that right off the top, there's less money available. Because keep in mind, more than anything else, and I like to stress this when I teach as well as talk to other groups, when a legislator sits down and looks at general revenue, so state dollars they have to spend, about 34 cents currently goes to public ed and about 31 cents goes to health and human service, mostly Medicaid. So almost two-thirds of the budget is off limits. Everything else after that is discretionary in their mind. And quite honestly, higher ed's the discretionary of the discretionary, because they got to fund transportation and water and prisons and all the other things that they have to fund. We can talk a little bit more about what the next session will hold, but I think clearly they could agree upon for higher ed they wanted to do tuition revenue bonds for universities.
Yeah, and I think there's one other thing, and this is a blessing and a curse for you. They like you. No, I mean, really. No, they like you. They like community colleges. They like the mission of community colleges. They like the general concept of you, and they like the specific qualities of what you bring to communities. It is a hard thing for me to go into the legislature and say, and find somebody to say, we think the community college structure is bad and wasteful, and, you know, we think we should get rid of it. Because and I can, for virtually any other state entity, I can find somebody who will say that, right? If you say that about the Health and Human Services Commission or the Department of Insurance or four-year colleges or whatever, there's somebody who will say, I think those are bloated, corrupt institutions that ought to be got rid of. You guys, they like you, but they also want to do stuff because they like you, right? And a lot of times what you wind up with is you all represent complex ideas and complex institutions. And you all are arguably very much ahead of some significant curves that are very popular curves for the Texas legislature. For instance, demand-driven services. You all already interface with your communities and interface with businesses in your communities and interface with the student needs in your communities and get in there and provide services on a sort of demand basis. You don't sit there as this sort of startling pure entity and say, you come to me and I'll decide whether you're worthy or not, right? You all actually are providing community services already and well interfaced with the community. What happens is that sometimes policymakers, sort of big picture policymakers, instead of just celebrating the fact that you're already there, doing that thing that you need to do and trying to do it better, what they'll do is they'll say, I want a piece of that. I know this thing that works real well. Block scheduling is a great example of this, right? We know this thing that works real well. Let's get everybody to do it. And then we've participated. We've done this thing. We've improved community colleges by making sure that everybody does this thing that works great. And the answer is, well, block scheduling works great for some things at some institutions and for other things at other institutions, that we're already doing it in terms of where it works and where it doesn't work and that kind of thing. That's our point of view. That's certainly been the faculty point of view. And yet there is this idea that we love community colleges and we want to help you. We want to help you be better. And we heard block scheduling is great. Let's do that, right? And so that's it. Your popularity is a blessing and a curse. It is very doubtful that they're going to try to eliminate you. And yet the problem is that they're, from time to time, they're really going to try to help you.
And that's usually when I say, please stop helping.
Yes, ma'am. Yes.
One is about block scheduling. In a document that I was reading from our college, it says that there is the possibility of for it not to happen, and it's mostly for areas that already have it, basically. But you ask to you can request not to have it. The other thing is, Green College got almost $2.5 million more than we had kept the test. I have no conception of whether it seems to me $2.5 million is really good, but then I don't know what amounts you're talking about if you're saying that there was not enough money or that we didn't get enough money. I mean, $2 million for a small school set of about 19,000 students is really good.
On the block scheduling question in particular, so what passed in the end was that every institution must block schedule 5 programs that aren't currently block scheduled. We still have to work with the coordinating board through negotiated rulemaking to define what the heck block scheduling really means, as well as a petition process that the legislation contemplates for institutions to be able to petition the coordinating board for hardship. In other words, this is too difficult for us, or we don't have enough students to make block work, or whatever it may be. The other thing I'd like to point on the block scheduling bill by Representative Clardy is that it does have a sunset provision in 4 years. So the notion is we'll go through this process, the coordinating board will then produce reports to the legislature explaining the relative success or non-success of block scheduling. But to your question specifically about getting out of it, it's everyone has to do 5 new programs unless through this petition process you can demonstrate why it's a hardship at your institution to do that. And you know, the negotiations, one of the things that the governor's office and Representative Clardy was emphasizing to us is it couldn't be existing programs that are already blocked. In other words, you can't count those as one of the 5. They want it to be new programs. But you know, we indicated that for some institutions, particularly some very small rural institutions, that would be a difficult process to set up.
And that's also a penalty for those people who are already already doing this thing, right? So theoretically a basis for hardship would be, hey, we're out ahead of this thing, we're already doing it. We can't do 5 new ones because we're already doing it. So it's what it became, I think at the end of the day, is that there was a sense, well, there's no sense about it. That was a bill that had a lot of very hard push behind it. It had a lot of hard push from both the executive branch and the legislative branch. It started out as you guys will just do block scheduling.
All programs
would be block scheduled. Good luck in September. And yeah, please.
So my question is there evidence, and do we have data of those institutions who are already doing block scheduling, and what were the hurdles that they had to go through? Because I see an issue with financial aid.
Sure.
For health sciences.
Right, right. I mean, I think there is some existing information. I think part of the notion behind policy leaders to do the bill that we ended up with was to gather more information once all institutions have to implement some form of block scheduling. I mean, one of the things that we consistently pointed to the governor's office, particularly if you look at the most effective use of block scheduling has been in the Tennessee Technical College system. Well, those students are all full-time and they all have full scholarships. So of course the outcomes are going to be really good for those students. So in some ways, going through almost a pilot process, although I know five programs for every college doesn't really feel like a pilot, but I think the notion is that way we'll generate some information and see, is it effective, isn't it effective? Are there financial aid impacts? Are at some institutions, what I've heard from some, you know, leaders has been, we may not be able to recruit enough students to go into a block. We might offer it, but we don't necessarily have the students that are willing to take that option.
And I think you raise a very good point, right? Because TCCTA opposed this all the way through the legislature, and we testified against it, and it was awesome. And you all ought to, in my opinion, be proud of your leadership, because they took hits for going in and opposing this bill that was very strongly supported on the record, in the microphone. Everybody got mad. But I think the realization from the process, from both the efforts of TAC and TCCTA, was, you know, we thought this was a good idea. Nobody was trying to destroy community colleges or do something bad to you. They thought they were doing something good, and they realized, wow, there are question mark after question mark after question mark about this whole thing. I mean, just exactly what you're saying. Where's the data? How does this work? How does it work for different campuses, for different programs, et cetera, et cetera? And I think what we wound up with in the end is something that is just fraught with discretion. That you've got a rulemaking from the Higher Ed Coordinating Board, you have the power of the commissioner to give hardship exemptions, you have a sunset provision that sort of creates approve me for the program itself. So what they did, to take all of that complexity and put it into something simple, they scaled back the ambition significantly and they created it as discretionary.
Right.
And now we're negotiating, yeah. as a function of that.
Yes, my school offered for the fall an optional block in gen ed, but students haven't signed up for it. So addressing just what you said.
Right. Well, as been pointed out to me by several instructional administrators as well as presidents, if I offer nobody enrolls, does that meet the requirements? I would say yes, because the legislation says you have to offer. You don't have to fill it with students. You just have to offer a block option.
If a block scheduling falls in the forest and no one hears it, it'd actually make a noise.
I'm not saying. Let me come back, though, to your question about the funding. Blinn College is a fast growth institution. And if you look at the growth, particularly at the Brazos County campus, there's been enormous amounts of growth. To give you some sense, across all institutions as a statewide, we saw an actual 1.4% decline in funding from the previous budget cycle. So I think for Blinn, the amount you're talking about, if I remember correctly, was about a 3 or 4% increase. So you're seeing a significant, I mean, if overall the state number was down 1.4, any institution that's receiving additional money is mostly driven by enrollment. And we did see, I mean, down 1.4% is not good, but out of the 50 districts, 9 had their highest appropriation in history. And so we've got this real separation between institutions of those that are growing quickly and those that are more, you know, stable or maybe even declining. To give you some sense, is anyone from Howard College here? Howard College, we had a hold harmless put in place, so nobody's going to lose more than 10%, but Howard would have lost 16% of their state funding. And if you know anything about Big Spring, my wife's from Midland, so I go to Big Spring pretty regularly. It's not like you've got full-time faculty everywhere, so you can't just scale a program down and then hope to scale it back up at some point, because there's just not going to be the capacity to do that. So there's some very hard decisions at some institutions. But I think the other thing I'd say about the budget is, you know, we've been doing some pretty deep analysis over the past 4 to 5 biennia. If you look at at least the last 4 biennia, our funding for community colleges is essentially at the top line dollar amount stayed flat. It's about $1.77 billion, within a little bit of variation off of that. Meanwhile, enrollment has continued to increase. And so I think, as one of our presidents said, you have to keep in mind for the legislature, they see community colleges as just a budget item, an expenditure in their overall budget. And they say, well, we did 1.77 last time, let's just do 1.77 again. But so for in Blinn's instance, you're seeing that increase, but you're bucking the trend when the whole state was down 1.4%.
Can you talk about the dual credits where there's no limit anymore to the dual credits?
Yeah, there were two bills that were passed, one HB 505 by Representative Rodriguez, and the other HB 18 by Chairman Aycock on the public ed side. 18 has quite a few provisions in it. It's what we like to call a late train bill. It's a bill that they put in as a shell, knowing at the end they'll throw in a bunch of stuff that hasn't been able to get passed. Both of those bills, though, contain provisions that remove the limitation on the number of dual credit hours a student can enroll in a semester, in a year, and in the total amount of time they're in high school. It also removes the prohibition against freshmen and sophomores taking dual credit courses. So we're going to see an expansion of dual credit across the state. I mean, we've already seen enormous expansion, but I think it's going to just increase more and more. So I've heard some leaders concerned, though, with if you see that much of a run-up and you start seeing high schools, are you going to have to see a substantive change if a student can earn 50% of a degree at the high school through dual credit? Are you going to have to go to Sachs and get a substantive change because that's now a facility in which you're offering half of a degree?
And that's going to be that will continue to be a gigantic issue because there are a whole lot of people now who would like to require that that high school students have the opportunity to take the full core curriculum, so that there would be a provision that said by law, if you are a high school student in Texas, you have to have access to 42 hours of dual credit courses. I mean, there are the unspoken part of it is the hinge between high school and college and the economies that can take place there. It's one thing to say we want students to be successful and we want them to be able to earn these degrees and be able to get into college. At some point or another, the legislature will come and say, hey, high schools and colleges, we're getting a twofer here, which means we need to see a significant reduction somewhere. And that's dangerous ground.
And dual credit in general, I mean, TACC working with CCAT and with TCCTA has talked about, we formed a task force internal to TACC to look specifically at dual credit issues. Because the fear, as Beaman says, is that over time it's going to continue to grow. And what will happen if we don't get ahead of the policy curve on some of these issues, the legislature is going to define them for us. And right. So everything from how you offer, you know, whether or not it's faculty at the high school or faculty from the college or a combination. I mean, what I hear from a lot of staffers is how can there be a differential and some students in this state pay a tuition and other students don't pay a tuition for dual credit. We did a survey, it's probably been about 5 or 6 years ago, just a lay of the land survey, and as you can imagine, it's all over the board. Some colleges don't charge, some do. Some charge a discounted rate in part of their district and a full rate in the rest of the district. It's a business decision based upon service area and taxing district, quite honestly. Yeah. Did you have a question?
That's sort of related to what I was thinking about. You know, we've got 50% of our students teaching these classes in high school. Are high school instructors teaching these? Are faculty going to be teaching these? Or have they not hashed that out yet?
I mean, I think at this point it's clearly driven by the institution making that decision. I know that, you know, Dr. Holdes here from Kilgore, I know in many more rural colleges you tend to want to have, if you can have the high school faculty, you know, accredited and able to teach the class, you'd prefer that. But then you get differentials in terms of who pays the high school teacher. I mean, you know, it's one of those policy areas where it was a wonderful decision to make a decade ago and throw it open for dual credit, the 12 hours offered for any student. The problem is they didn't define on how that, so it's just a policy vacuum that you guys have rushed in to fill, and now some of the universities are coming in as well.
Yeah, and it creates these, since everybody sort of made it work, on the one hand, which is awesome, they've made it work, but then you've created sort of these those kind of, it's mature enough now so that you're starting to feel some frictions, right? That there's a, you know, the cross application of this from one institution to another, one school district will do it one way, one will do it another way. Constituents of politicians will move, right, and think they're going to be getting the same deal in one school district that they got in another school district, and it turns out to be radically different, and they complain to the legislature. There will be, I think that there will be a push for commonality. And as Steve said, I think it's super important for us, one, to celebrate it as an opportunity for us to get out in the community and do good, but two, to make sure that we're doing some good hard policy thinking about it so that when, and I won't even say when, I think it's happening, that we need to weigh in on the policy end of it, figure out what we want, and then weigh in on the policy end of this now, because if we don't do it, somebody else is going to do it, and we're either going to be somewhat at the table or we're going to be chasing the table.
So
HB 18 includes some language that mirrors SAC's language on, you know, being qualified to teach. There is some other language specifically for CTE at the high school level, allowing those with an associate's degree and number of years of experience to teach, not the college level course, but the high school level CTE courses. I think the one, we talk about policy happening. I would point to one bill this session that we worked very hard on, and it still passed, although in a modified form, but is an example of them trying to do policy to community colleges, and that's Senate Bill 182 by Senator Betancourt, which essentially requires the four community colleges in Harris County to have to sign an agreement with every single school district in Harris County to offer at least one dual credit course. The bill as filed said Harris County and all adjacent counties, which would have pulled in 10 community colleges. The thought there is that it's really the superintendents and the ISDs that are pushing to be able to have their students shop amongst community colleges to take those courses. So the way the bill passed, with those four community colleges each having to have an agreement with each ISD, the student decides where they want to take that course. The colleges don't have to have a full menu of courses, they have to offer at least one, but the fear is that is that going to be a model that is seen to be taken across the state, where you just open it up and allow students to shop amongst our institutions. That has significant impacts and significant effects on service areas versus taxing districts within our institutions, which I'm sure you know vary across the state significantly. I do expect, as we go into this next session during the interim, Beaman and I have talked extensively about this, there's going to be interim charges in both substantive committees, House and Senate, to look at service area issues, to look at dual credit issues. So we're going to have to be doing this process work. It's not, as Beaman said, it's not going to happen. It's happening right now.
Right. Yeah, Essie.
I wanted you to take a moment to address concealed handguns on campus before we run out of time.
I was going to bring that up, but go ahead, Beaman.
Sure. Sure. I would say one last thing about dual credit before we do guns, and that is that it's a family problem for me because my wife is an AP government teacher at Bowie High School, and my dad teaches for ACC, and he will be on the Bowie campus this year, and I don't know what that's going to do to my family.
So does AISD rate, or do they give a bump for AP courses and not dual credit courses in GPA?
No, they give bumps for both courses.
Good.
Yeah. So it's... But mostly it's going to be those two teaching styles clashing, father-in-law and daughter-in-law, and me being related to both of them really closely. Yeah.
Many universities do not grant some of the acceptance credits for some of the dual credit courses, so they will accept the credit.
Right.
At the private institution level. I used to work at a private institution, and we were able to make those choices.
And the same way that the private institution can recognize certain scores on AP tests and not other scores. Guns. I would start by saying this. I cannot emphasize enough the amount of energy related to firearms at the legislature this time. All day, every day, for 140 days, there were people with rifles slung across their backs outside of the legislature. There were a tremendous number of people. The gun advocacy groups at the legislature this session completely pulled out all the stops. I mean, it was absolutely amazing. The opening day of the legislature, January 13th, the whole front of the Capitol along 11th Street was long rifle folks and open carry people with their weapons. In very great, and I mean, and I will say this too. I will say this in as a compliment to that advocacy group. They were good advocates. I was worried that day because I was involved in a thing where we were having an ecumenical prayer service on the south steps that opened with an Islamic imam calling people to prayer right with the long gun people, and everything worked out great. So. Hooray. But I guess the point I would say to you first is that your issue with guns on campus was a subset of an enormous issue at the legislature relating to Second Amendment and gun rights. It was absolutely staggering to me how many, and I've been doing this for a long time, and I've worked on gun issues for a long time, and it was just absolutely amazing to me just how much energy there was in the Capitol around and related to guns. There were three big issues related to guns, open carry, constitutional carry, which basically says the abridges the state from making a rule or law about the carrying or owning of a firearm, and guns on campus. And that was the trifecta. And all three of those went to the very end of the session, as you know. We worked very hard in two respects, as many of you probably know because you received information on it from TCCTA and from their blog. We worked hard to work through our committee structure and define exactly where we stand. You, as TCCTA, had some people who were in favor of the right to carry concealed firearm, had a majority of you who were in favor of current law, which would ban concealed firearms from the college campuses. We supported a policy of institutional prerogative, but full institutional prerogative, saying that institutions can decide what they can do and what they can't do, recognizing the significant minority of your membership that might have been in favor of firearms, but the majority that was against. The fight in the legislature on the issue was terrible, in that it was very highly passionate. It was filled with victims of violence who were in favor of gun rights. It was filled with people, victims of violence, who were opposed to gun rights, all in the same room together in a sort of a pressure cooker environment, all of whom deserved respect for their point of view and for their loss. And then this overarching politics, I start with that because it's easy on the gun issue to say, well, it's this crazy gun thing and it's all ideological, but there's a real human face in it on both sides of the issue. And we spend a lot of time in the room with that human face. And it's worthy of note that there are people who are very much in favor of all kinds of gun rights and carrying options that feel like they really have a good reason and are people who've suffered real loss. So that being said, there was an overarching ideological issue that was also pushing it, a very strong political issue. One of the things that you all need to do to understand lobbying and grassroots is go and look on the website of your elected, of your senator and your representative, and see how many clicks you have to do to get their NRA rating. Usually on their home page, like you look up Representative X, it'll say A rating from the NRA on their homepage, on the very first place you go when you Google them, because it's that important to them, because the NRA is that energetic lobby, and the politics in Texas being what they are.
It's also world politics, right? Like you said, the Beaman and the steps have created a problem. We've seen the beginning of the politics, the beginning of the
sure.
Christians, and people are scared.
Sure. Sure, there's a which is one of the reasons that we said, what's the fundamental question here, and ultimately becomes a question of diversity, right? We have institutions that are really different, and Frank Phillips College is different than Houston Community College, and Odessa College is different than the Dallas College District, and ACC is different than wherever, right? And so what we were interested in was institutional choice. And again, this is not an accident. This was in 4 years of consultation with you all about a proper course of action for TCCTA. It's a hard one for us, right? And so that's what we pushed. The bill that really was the sled for this was Senate Bill 11 by Senator Birdwell from Waco. He was passionate about this issue, and I mean passionate with a capital P. He pushed a very strong bill out of the Senate And when we went to him and talked about the choices for institutions, there was a strange and serious inequity in the bill, in our opinion, and that is that private institutions were offered the option of allowing guns on campus or not. They were treated as general private property. Public institutions were not offered that option. Senator Birdwell's concept in that was that, well, you have the collision of two really strong constitutional commitments. One is the right to bear arms, and the other is private property and property ownership. And he said that the private property, he could see not allowing a private property owner to say no, but he couldn't see that for institutions. What we argued was, this is not about public and private property, this is environmental. Right, his own bill said you shouldn't carry them in bio laboratories and sporting events, for instance. So we said the logic of your own bill indicates that there are environments that are improper for the carrying of concealed weapons. We're saying we know the environments of our campuses better than anybody. Let us make that choice, right? And the rest is history. It was a long, hard argument all the way through the legislative session. At the end of the day, and when I say the end of the day, I mean the end of the day, they went to a conference committee on it, and they came out with, what they wound up having was an amendment that said that public institutions could decide where guns could not be allowed, but it could not, but their decision could not have the character of banning guns on all of campus. Right. In other words, they said, there will be guns on campus. Now go forth and make the rule, and we'll evaluate whether your rule has the character of doing that. Yet again, very much like the block scheduling, it threw it into the realm of discretion.
Yeah.
Yes.
You are not exempt just simply because of that. The way that SB 11 ended up was your chancellors or presidents will have the ability to create rules that, as Beaman say, you cannot carry guns on this part of the campus. The legislation is very specific, though, in saying you cannot create regulations that prohibit it across or have the effect of prohibiting it across an entire campus. Now, there's a lot of that that is open to interpretation. I think the thing that, and I've talked to some of our university colleagues, this is going to get litigated at some point.
Oh, yeah.
Because some institution, a community college, university, is going to have rules that someone is going to interpret as generally prohibiting on a campus. The one thing that I would point out is that, so those rules are promulgated by the CEO in consultation with faculty, staff, and students. Those rules then within 90 days have to be reviewed by your boards of trustees. They can either be amended or wholly replaced by a two-thirds vote of your boards. The one real distinction, though, is for the universities, they must put this in place by next summer, 2016. For community colleges, it's not till August of 2017. And so we have an extra year to watch some of this be put into place at our sister institutions at the university level. And I think it's going to allow institutions to have conversations, kind of what you mentioned about what are there, and it is the case we made during the session. Look, we're different than universities. We have school-age children on our campuses. And so therefore, TACC and CCAT's position, the Trustees Association, from the very beginning was we prefer not to have guns on campus at all. If it was to pass, we wanted our boards to make those decisions completely for the reasons that Beaman expressed. I think allowing the ability to promulgate some rules and put part of the campuses off limits, I think is a positive step. We would have preferred to have complete ability to opt in or opt out one way or the other, and additionally maybe create rules where we're going to opt out, but it is allowed on this part of a campus. I can tell you that because in so many legislative efforts, when they're negotiated at the end, an amendment, as Beaman said, is thrown up, it's usually very vague, and therefore we end up either the legislature having to come back to redefine, or we end up in the courts at some point. And I honestly think that's where that's headed. The other thing that we pointed out to the trustees and the presidents is, wherever you're going to promulgate these rules, you have to put up what are called 30-06 signs. It's the part of the code 30.06. ironic, that there are some costs there, right? I mean, those are going to have to be prominently placed on campuses where guns are not going to be allowed. And it's an affirmative defense for a CHL holder that they go on a part of campus where it's not allowed and it's not properly signed, then that's an affirmative defense against any kind of a criminal penalty. The other thing I'd point out is, you know, Beaman said it was the troika of those three big efforts. Constitutional carry did not see the light of day, but open carry did for current CHL holders. There was an amendment accepted on Senator Birdwell's bill, though, that for CHL holders, they will not be able to open carry on a college campus where they would be able to conceal carry. So then there will not be open carry on campuses at all.
And that was important. Richard will tell you that he had members come to him and say, if we get open carry on campuses, I quit. Right. Because the last thing you want is negotiating a grade with a guy who's wearing his leg iron or whatever.
You'd rather just guess whether or not they're packing.
That's right. You'd rather just guess. But it was, I think it is very likely that you're going to see some institution say something as general as we're certainly not banning concealed carry on campus, but we're banning it in classrooms. And then the question will become, does that constitute a practical the gun guys will file suit and say our rights are being abridged under the current state law by this adoption. And then a court will look at it and say, does a ban in classrooms constitute a practical ban on the entire campus in contravention of state law? And so... Well, we're seeing that... And that becomes a real issue, right? Because this issue has actually happened in terms of private property, right? Because there's a big business issue about the allowance of guns in parking lots. Right. I have to drive to work and I drive through a neighborhood that I feel like I need a gun in. But when I get to work, I don't know what to do with my gun because I'm not allowed to take it inside. And my company also says I can't have it in the car in the parking lot. And there've been USAA right here in San Antonio fought against a bill that would have required them to allow guns in their parking lot because they have a security area that you work in at USAA, right? And so I think it's a opportunity for entrepreneurialism that you can become the mobile gun locker and get licensed and bonded and basically wheel a safe around in a cart and keep people's guns for them when they go into these places. But all kidding aside, you raised this super important point, right? That we're not ready to be an armed society.
Or in an armed, either way.
We're not ready just to be, you know, little Joe, you know, riding into Reno wearing his pistol. But we're also in this just hot debate about the right to bear arms. Concealed carry is a compromise, right? Concealed carry says, well, if I'm concealing the weapon and it's not on my person, or you can't see it, it's not intimidating you in a direct way, and you can carry it and you don't, and that's fine. But if I'm a concealed carry, if I'm a person who's in the habit of wearing a weapon, and I'm seeing 30-06 signs all over the place, life gets complicated in a hurry. Because right. If I was planning to go shopping at Whole Foods, and they put up a 30-06 sign, now what do I do? Right?
Go to HEB,
right. but it's really complicated. And you guys are at the, because of Senate Bill 11 and because of the very specific issues related to guns on campus and the Virginia Tech shootings and other similar events, you guys are at the epicenter of this really potent discussion in our society about how do we do this?
Right. Go ahead.
If the gun and they are significant because if the gun is not concealed, even if the gun is doing what's called printing, and that is if I'm wearing it, but there's a visible outline of a weapon in a place where they are not allowed to, where open carry is not allowed, the printing of a weapon, even if it's a place where concealed carry is allowed, constitutes an offense. And so it's complicated and esoteric, right? You have to say, you know, in no event is the person allowed to pull it out, show it, brandish it, certainly, and even the printing. One of the responsibilities of being a concealed carry permit holder is that you have to know how to do it such that the weapon is actually concealed. And so, yeah, they're not, if you can see it, it's an offense under that law.
And I think that points to much of the concern of administrators is we're going to have to promulgate rules on how this is going to operate on college campuses. Clearly, where they're not allowed, that's one set of rules, but where they're allowed, that's a different set of rules. I heard from many of the chiefs of police at both universities and community colleges that they're going to have additional training for their staff to how to deal with now there's going to be these other guns on campus. What happens if they roll up on some sort of an incident and multiple people have guns out? That takes an additional amount of training. So there's costs that are built in there. But I would just echo real quick. I mean, I think what Beaman pointed out at the beginning of this discussion is very important. I was surprised, and I've been around for over 20 years at the Capitol and seen some pretty controversial things over the years. This sucked more oxygen out of the room in multitude of settings that they could have been dealing, not just with higher ed issues, but many other policy areas. And it created a lot of bad feelings amongst members as well. And you know, as you can imagine, the testimony, as I think Beaman kind of alluded to, was very heated, very heartfelt on both sides of the aisle. I'll tell you, just as an aside, personally, I found the most compelling arguments, although I don't think they really cut through some of the noise, was not the arguments of the lone gunman that comes on campus and somebody needs to defend, that sort of stuff. It was from some of the mental health advocates pointing out that you're going to see probably increased suicide rates because of the availability of guns on campus. And you know what it's like to be 21 years old and your life falls apart. And so I found that very compelling. For legislators driven by the Second Amendment issues, though, that's just not important. What's important is that you cannot infringe upon the rights of those to carry. And they do have valid points, but you've got to realize the repercussions of that.
No, you boldly grade them what they earn, and we'll work on the rest of this.
Well, as I understand it, there's a lot of talk about permit, about having to be trained to carry a weapon and get something from the state saying it's okay to carry a weapon. Who's going to be enforcing that? Who's going to be checking that? How are we going to know?
To the extent that right now there's a permitting process in place. It's administered by the Department of Public Safety, the DPS. One of the things that's really important in this thing, and it's marginally important to us because we have non-traditional students, but the actual rules of the concealed carry process apply, starting with you have to be 21,
right?
Unless you're active duty military. So it's not going to be little kids necessarily carrying the weapons. It's going to be older kids. Now, we have lots of older kids and straight up grown-ups and whatnot on our campuses. And then the second is all of those things that apply when you're getting the permit, that you can't be a felon, that you can't be a fugitive from justice, that you that you can't have been convicted or even arrested for domestic abuse or domestic battery. There's a laundry list of DQs for getting a concealed handgun license that are supposed to ultimately ensure that the people carrying are not maniacs, right? Whether that works or not is we're going to find out. We're going to get the data for it. You know, so far, I will tell you the one thing that the gun advocates will say, and they say it vociferously, is that when the concealed carry law passed, it had the usual political hyperbole on both sides. One side saying, if you're not carrying a weapon and you walk down the street in Austin, Texas, a million horrible things will happen to you that shouldn't have happened to you because this is America. And the other side saying, if we pass this law and have concealed gun-related violence, there's going to be a shootout on Congress Avenue in Austin, Texas every day of the week because people are going to have guns and they're going to get inflamed at the gas station when somebody pulls in front of them. They're going to pull out a gun and shoot them, right? And that's one of the things that's really interesting when we do this kind of work. If you engage in that kind of hyperbole and you lose, then you own the hyperbole, right? And so, which is why you should never engage in hyperbole. You should just give as accurate an answer as you can, because right now the people who are against the proliferation of guns in our society are a little bit on their heels in Texas because the pro-gun lobby goes to their dire predictions of what would happen if we passed CHL and says, what? You know, this isn't, CHL holders are not involved in, are involved in hardly any crimes, right? Is essentially, and that's an accurate statistic. And so part of what we, part of the problem that we have is we really don't know how to measure the impact of all of this stuff until it's already happened, and all people all over this argument have already sort of damaged their own credibility by engaging in hyperbole on the front side and having to own it on the back side. And so we don't know what's going to happen.
Beaman, Steve mentioned sucking all the oxygen out of the room with this issue. Every time we talk about this at our conferences, it, as soon as we start talking about guns on campus, we never get to anything else. And it's because our people care about it so much. It's a deeply personal issue that affects our sense of safety. But I would like to bring some oxygen back into the room and talk about some other things.
We
can
talk about other things.
We lost this session on a lot of issues. I mean, and it wasn't just we're not going to fund you, but we'll help in these other areas. They didn't help us in the other areas either. And Beaman, I think you're right. Legislators like us, but they didn't show us really any deference or any, we want to bring your wisdom to bear on our decision. How do we change that? We've got, the session just ended, we got another one coming in a year and a half. How do we change the outcome next session? How do we change the conversation, provide a frame that sticks with the legislators so that they don't just kind of freelance and just they're brand new to the legislature and have all the answers, but feel like they need to engage with the people who do this for a living? What do you think we need to do between now and next session to get a different result next time?
Well, I think a couple of things that we've already talked about. We need to recognize those policy areas, and I agree with you, right? We had a lot of people come in who said, one of the problems with lots of new people coming in the current American political paradigm, not just Texas, but all over the country, is everybody comes in as a reformer, right? What does Pappy O'Donnell say in Oh Brother, Where Art Thou, the great Coen Brothers film that all of you should watch immediately? You know, he says, one of his guys says, we need to get some of that reform. And he says, how am I supposed to get reform as a incumbent, you moron? You know, I mean, it's that there's an idea that there's virtue in reform. And that we have, just for whatever reason in this political paradigm in Texas, that the legislature is undergoing a massive, profound generational change. A massive and profound generational change. And it's just full of new people who have ideas about what they want to do, but don't have the institutional knowledge to know to whom to go to talk about it, and how to actually interface with TCCTA or TAC or any other group that might have some real wisdom on this. What we have to do is get out there to these new guys and say, there are structures that are not threatening to your cause that you need to know about and be allied with. That it's kind of like all the way back to Community College 101. We've been blessed over the past, I would say, 15 years with some real champions who are leaving us, dadgummit. And we need to, and we're just going to have to do what you have to do in this business, which is retool that whole set of relationships. It's definitely people who do it for a living. It's a huge deal for us. But man, it is really useful for you all to talk to your senator and your state rep about what you do and say, look, I know you guys are interested in community colleges. I'm a person who knows a lot about it. I'm leading from the middle, dadgum. And let me tell you how this works. Let me tell you what it looks like up the stairs and down the stairs from my unique position as somebody who's working in the strong operational level in community colleges. So I think, and that's not a Pollyanna answer, that's real. We need legislators to be interfacing with the institutions in their district and with their actual constituents who care about this stuff. And we need you guys to talk to them about it, however you want to talk to them about it. Just realities of my business, you know. And we always say invite them to the classroom, but invite them to the classroom is like step number three or five or seven or whatever, because they're just a celebrity there who they go into campaign mode sometimes. When they show up there, it's really good to go to their office and talk to them. I will tell you this, as jaded as people get about politics in general in the modern United States of America, there are very, very few true sociopaths in the legislature. And
maybe more in the lobby.
Well, yeah, plenty in the lobby. But in the legislature, virtually 100% of the people who have cared to get elected actually don't want to destroy stuff. They want to do good. It's just a question of knowing what good is. I mean, really, what we do is profoundly educational, much more than it is persuasive. And it is, but it's complicated, man. Texas has just become a full-on mega country. I mean, what, we're the, what's our latest celebratory number? We're either the ninth or the eighth largest economy in the world in Texas. Yeah, there you go. And so, but that comes with attendant stuff, right? I mean, we're bigger than Denmark, and, you know, it's a whole country, right? And so we, so when you say, you know, what was the old Texas thing, you know, Texas is a whole other country, well, it really is now. It is economically, and it is in terms of population, and it is in terms of complexity, which means that they are dealing with a high level of noise, and you guys need to go and be constructive noise.
And to kind of piggyback on that, we are the eighth or ninth largest economy. When I teach government, I like to point out to students, you're living in a 21st century state with a 19th century form of government, essentially. They're part-time, they only come in 140 days every 2 years. How much, you know how much they make annually to be a state legislator, senator, or House member? $7,200 a year. Yeah, I mean, you get a lot of part-time legislators who have money elsewhere. But to kind of piggyback on what Beaman said, so what that means is their bandwidth to get convinced of what the priority should be for them in any given session is very narrow. And you've got to do it during the interim. And I tell our folks consistently, if you're doing it in January of a session year, it's too darn late, because their focus gets narrow and narrower as we go through a session, simply because they can't cut through all the noise. So one of the things I like to point out too, and it's a little bit Pollyanna, but you've got to convince. You're right. Beaman's right. You've got to go in. You need to do it. Not just presidents, not just VPs. Faculty, administrators need to go in and do it. But more importantly, I would argue, and my presidents have heard me say this before, always keep in mind that data is fact. Data is not truth. What they want is they want a truth. They want to buy your story, right? And that's the most effective people around the Capitol are the ones who can get legislators to adopt their story as their own story. So they like you. They like community colleges, right? They know about their community college back home. They want to come and talk in front of a class, and Beaman's right. They click into campaign mode. That's not the same thing as them adopting your story of the impact you have on students, on the community, on businesses. And so what I like to say is get them to buy into your story. I don't know how many times we've sat in a hearing room and somebody comes with reams and reams of data and a PowerPoint, and the legislators glaze over, and then you hear a little scuffle at the end of the dais, and one member says, you know what, my son's friend, when he went to college, he couldn't have this happen, or he didn't get this class transferred. And we stop talking about the data that was in the PowerPoint and start talking about anecdote. And policy is done on stories and anecdotes, quite honestly. And so you've got to use data to inform, but you got to come up with a story to get them to buy into.
Yeah, and the most powerful thing is a story that's a compelling story that is then supported by all the data.
Exactly.
That it's really a both and thing, right? That you, because the other side of it is the isolated anecdote that is not compelling, right? That and so what you want, and we've kind of touched on it in all of these issues, right? That the anti-gun guys have to own the dire prediction not coming true, and in the same way, if you go in and you say, I have a story that's a compelling story, but it's the last lonely dot at the end of the bell curve and really won't be supported, you know, by any data when it actually comes to the policy discussion, that's no good. If you can basically say, here's my experience, I'm teaching, you know, 220 kids a semester, and this is what I'm seeing in terms of my sample, and it's for real, and I'm going to see them all four or five times next week, and that winds up being borne out by the data, that's powerful. You know, if you say, I'm basically wearing three hats, and I'm assuming that, again, because you all are at this particular conference, all of you wear at least two hats and maybe seven at your institutions, that there are, that basically describe those different hats. Say, look, I have several different core functionalities at my institution, puts me in a good place to sort of see what's going on. Here's what's going on. And that's, I will tell you that, and again, all kidding aside, I say the sociopath thing sometimes, but I will say it in a positive way. The vast majority of legislators want to do the right thing. They want to do good. And if you give them an opportunity by arming them with some knowledge to do good, you can be surprised at the result. Also recognize that there are competitors out there. This world is full of people who have never spent a day employed by community colleges who know all about you and know what's best for you. And so you got to get in there and compete with that. Sir?
You know, I totally agree with you that they want to do good. However, I think they see community colleges much like a Walmart opportunity. And that is that first they can get some goods at a cheaper cost.
Right.
And so what they see for us then is that I don't know that they are as concerned about the end product as they are concerned about the cost. And so they're able to argue then that they're able to get all of these young people into colleges, but I'm not convinced yet that they're concerned that once that individual has completed that project, they want us to do the things to get people into the workforce.
Sure.
But they're not that sure how successful those individuals are going to be in the workforce. But what we have done, and we've done it exceedingly well, is that they've continued to cut the budget. And we've done more with less.
Right.
And as long as we're able to do that and we have a substantial number of our students who are successful, then it's working for them.
Right.
And so their love for us is a true love.
It's conditional.
I feel the conditional love.
Yeah, that's right, right? I mean, and that's always the, you all operate in a profound environment of moral hazard, right? I mean, you really do. Because, and we had this argument about success points. So we testified in front of a committee, not this session, but last session. And the metaphor of the mace of rigor was sort of the conversation in the committee where the chairman of the committee was fond and had used it many times. Dan Branch had used many times this metaphor of the mace of rigor and the why. Do you know why they carry a mace at these graduations? It's that because that's the mace of rigor, because that's the rigorousness of curriculum, blah, blah, blah. And we were worried about, frankly, about grade inflation. We were worried about exactly what you're describing, which is if we can Walmart these people out of college and they can have associate's degrees, it kind of doesn't matter what happens as long as we've got a metric that looks pretty good. And we as faculty were in there saying, we can't be in that situation. And the riposte to us was always the same, which was, how dare you? Are you telling me that the judo throw, when we would go in and talk about this, or the attempted judo throw, Aikido for Richard, so you're coming in here and telling me that you guys have no professional standards. You know, we're relying on you for rigor and your professional standards. If you're telling us that we can pass a law and then you'll just give grades, why, how dare you, right? And our counter riposte, for you fencers in the crowd, or our remise, was, no, we love the mace of rigor. The problem is we think you're about to pry it out of our hands. The problem is that we not only do we hold on to it, we hold on proudly, we're holding on as hard as we can. You guys are passing laws that are trying to pull it out of our hands, right? So there is this, I think you put your finger right on it, man. There's an enormous tension between the value that we have, right? And the fact that we are a good bang for the buck, and we are we have done the thing, and we have stretched that nickel until it's about 300 yards long and then as thin as a human hair. And they want us to take it out to 500 yards. And the question is, are we going to keep doing that, you know, or are we going to basically, you know, sabotage the system? Are we going to stop working? As, you know, at what point do we start to lose good people in the system because they're being asked to do something that really can't be done? And all of those are the complex tensions that we're talking about, which is precisely why we need to talk. I mean, we can construct an enormously complex narrative with the complex tension. I'm one of the reasons I love doing work in y'all's subject matter and with you guys is that it's complicated. And there are, and I told Richard early on, well, we had a conversation when I first started working for TCCTA, where we were talking about just sort of the general environment of community colleges. And he said, well, you know, we go to the Capitol and we walk into offices and they're really nice to us and talk to us. And I say, well, you might get less popular when we really start asking for stuff, you know, because that's a social barrier that you have to breach at some point in the legislature where they say, you know, we could love you if you just quit asking. To which we say,
that's what I tell my son.
That's right. To which we say then, but yeah, but we wouldn't be serving the state. Because you guys need to know. When you've got a system that's still serving you but is unsustainable and is about to break, it's our responsibility to tell you. And that's kind of what we're doing with community colleges right now. We're saying, yes, we're making it work. Yes, it's a time-honored system. It's got a great structure in Texas. It serves 254 counties in Texas. It has been flexible and adaptable, and it has done a whole bunch of stuff for the business community and for the college community and for kids and for everybody else. But don't put us in a situation where you just use us up, where you ride us to death. At some point or another, you got to take a break and let us drink out of the trough and feed us something. And that's kind of, I would say that that's where we are, and that's why your narratives are so important.
Because, I mean, yeah, I agree, and I think fundamentally the issue with the legislature, and I think you identify it, is when I first started at TACC, I'd been in other parts of the policy world, I was just shocked in that, you know, I had folks from the community college world come out and say, well, why won't they give us any more money? And it was pretty clear to me why they didn't, because you go back and you take care of business and you do what you have to do to educate the students and provide services to your community. So if I'm a legislator, what's my incentive to give you any more money? You sure seem to be doing a great job no matter how much money I give you. So to me, that's the next step, is what Beaman's talking about, is creating a narrative to kind of set off not an alert system so much, but to let them understand you're reaching capacity here. And if you want to see us continue to grow, if you look at Murdoch's numbers, by 2050 in his middle scenario, you guys are going to double in enrollment. Do you have the capacity at this funding level to double in enrollment? No. And so that needs to be some truth told to them of, yes, as Beaman said, you've ridden us this long, but you're reaching capacity.
And that's something I think we were talking earlier in the morning session about metrics, about collecting data, telling a story. And you look at the things that we do and the things that Texas relies on you to do, and it's enormous. I mean, the statistics I've heard is about 85% of nurses in Texas come out of community colleges. You get firefighters and EMT professionals about the same. We get just about everything that you would call a middle class from community colleges. The strategic weight of that is enormous, and it's taken for granted because it's painless. Legislators never feel a consequence from cutting or not increasing the funding. And so it's a matter of telling a story, and we do have a compelling story to tell, and also getting people to help us tell that story. Working with employers who say, this is what I'm needing, and I know you can't get it for free. You've got to pay for it, that we need to make this investment. Talking with communities, talking with local elected officials, your board members, people who have a stake in our success need to talk with legislators and say, we all need our community college to be successful. And that's true in a large urban area, and it's true in the smallest towns in Texas. And that's where I think where we've tried to come in as an organization is to do it as a real grassroots effort. This is not an AstroTurf, they call it AstroTurf, the opposite of grassroots, where it seems like the real thing, but it's really not. This is actual people who do this for a living and know what they're talking about. We try and give good information so that if you call your legislator because of one of our emails and the staffer there says, oh, we're not really doing that, well, we've given you real information that you can rely on and explain a thought-out, well-considered point of view. And that's a quality contact. That's not just like we automated some response system. And so that's the kind of community we need, and we think there's real power in that, and it's worth the legwork that it takes to get it. Lizanne. Right.
We were knocking at the door.
That's right. Right at the end of the session every May, we do a leadership retreat for with our executive committee and our committee chairs. And it just happened to be falling at a crucial time in the legislative session when the Guns on Campus bill was being dealt with. And so we changed our agenda at the last moment, and Essie was brilliantly led us in this effort to meet with legislators. And it was about 20 of our people who went out just on the spot and did it. It wasn't a whole lot of people, but it got noticed. And that's the thing, is that you've got to have people there, either in person or electronically, to communicate with legislators. Our challenge right now is that we did that and we still didn't get the result we wanted. The challenge I think we all face is, so what do we do about that? Do we say, well, we did everything right and we still didn't get it, so let's give up? Or do we find a way to refine our technique and engage more people to get a better result?
Yeah.
I think one thing we really have going for us is that we've got the best people I can imagine to advocate on our own behalf.
And I think you guys, I mean, and I would say you affected the bill. Because
That's
the
true.
Bill wound
That's
up,
true.
Because I mean, you profoundly affected that bill, because it was one or zero for 18 of the 20 weeks of the legislative session. Mm-hmm. It was privates get the opt out, publics don't. And at the very end of the deal, that effort, and the grassroots call-ins that we did and y'all's efforts with your presidents and everything, we again threw the bill into a space of delay and discretion that gives us a chance to really understand it better. So there's something there.
That's true. And that was referenced on the floor debate.
I've heard from all these people, blah, blah, blah. Yeah. Right. And that's you, and it's awesome, right? Mm-hmm. And so when we're talking about this stuff, it's not like a 0 to 100 kind of deal. I mean, this is happening, and you guys have been pretty good about it. I would plug the TCCTA resources for this, starting with the TCCTA blog that is just sort of a what the heck's going on and what do you need to think about and look for, and here's some basic information, and learn enough to be strong on the issues and learn the TCCTA perspective, and then meld that with whatever you guys fundamentally think. You know, what's great about you as a constituency is that you think for yourselves and you can read and write and you can really express yourselves. You're all good communicators.
Just one plug for us too. There is a session summary document that TACC's prepared that's on the TACC website under advocacy, which has got probably more than you ever want to know about budget stuff, but it exists there. We just recently wrapped it up. It's got some bill information too, but it's a good resource to be able to look and see. It's TACC.org. And there's under advocacy, you'll see legislative resources if you'd like to look. It's just, as I said, it's probably more than you want to know about budget stuff, but it's all there.
Yeah, so what's great about you guys is each one of you, has the capacity to be basically a high quality game changer person. And that makes you a really interesting constituency. And Richard and I have this conversation all the time. You can go for numbers, or you can go for quality, or you can go for both. And obviously what we want is both. But part of that bothness is relying on you all by saying, we're not going to give you the boilerplate letter that says, click here and it'll automatically go. We're going to say, you all express yourselves. But what that means is that when we go into an office, if you're in an office and you get five identical letters, or three identical letters, or maybe even two identical letters, you go, AstroTurf, and that starts going in the trash can. You all are a great constituency because you can both express yourself individually and understand the common ground very well and really be a powerful constituency, a powerful voice for yourselves in that regard.
And that's something I think coming out of this discussion and out of this conference, I hope you'll take two steps out of it. One is get informed, and the other is do something with the information, be engaged. And that's really what we're hoping comes of this. And we are developing partnerships, which seems to be a theme. It's our theme for this year, is the power of partnerships, is because we know that we're more effective when it's not everybody just doing things in isolation, but where there's an orchestrated message that's being delivered, where all of us are kind of amplifying that message. So I think that's what we can take away from it, and I hope you've seen from the discussion today the effort and the passion in the work that Steve and Beaman do on your behalf. This is something that is profoundly personal and has a very high, an enormous impact for our students and our state, and it's just not a struggle we can lose. So this, I'm sure, will be coming up in more discussions today and tomorrow. Let's take a quick break. We've got about 15 minutes.